Welcome everyone to this Garden Court and Netpol webinar on the question of how the Police Crime Sentencing and Courts Act will impact our rights to protest. The Garden Court protest team are here in the form of Owen Greenhall and Audrey Cherryl Mogan, and we're delighted to be joined by Lydia Dagostino of Kellys and Emily Apple of Netpol. And we're all going to be talking about different aspects of the new Act and also the looming specter of the new public order bill in terms of how they will or may affect our right to protest in the future. Now, these are undoubtedly dark times for the right to protest in England and Wales. Aside from those bills and acts that I've mentioned, we have the National Security Bill, which will almost certainly be used against activists, and the changes proposed to the Human Rights Act, which are designed to limit our freedom to express ourselves, our ability to challenge police action, and states' accountability in the courts. And the aim of this webinar is, first of all, to explain what has come in. I think more provisions came into force today from the Act. Explain what is coming in the form of the bill, and to educate people so that when you are going to a protest or demonstration, you know what to expect. But it's also there not to neutrally educate, but to serve as a warning and to galvanise lawyers, activists, and any right-thinking people into thinking about how we can oppose these changes, to share knowledge, to identify the cases so that we can look at appeals and challenging it through the courts. Not that we can necessarily rely on the courts. We await the outcome of the Attorney General's reference in the Colston statue case, which was being heard today and yesterday. But recent cases from the Court of Appeal and the High Court don't bode well for the right to protest, which had a brief moment in the sunshine following the Ziegler case that Owen and others were involved in the Supreme Court last year. That right, that brief moment in the sunshine is quickly being shoved behind a cloud again. And the question is really, I think, whether it will go back to how it was or whether things will get worse. And the other important thing, as well as challenging it through the courts, is to spread the word about just how bad, how draconian, how totalitarian these provisions are, because there is still a chance for the bill to be defeated, for changes could be made to the Act, but not if people don't speak out, if people don't protest against what is happening. If people don't show that they care and are upset that our rights and liberties are being eroded. So that is what we're aiming to do. A few housekeeping matters before I hand over to our first speaker. As you'll have seen when you joined the webinar, this is being recorded, and so any contributions will be caught by the recording. Just in case anyone wants to bear that in mind. There are should be at the bottom of your screen a button labelled Q&A for any questions. The format of the webinar will be that each of the speakers are going to speak on particular parts of the legislation. And then at the end, there'll be an opportunity for questions. So if you can put them in, we will deal with as many of those as possible. I think at least, possibly only one of the speakers is going to use some slides. Those will be sent out to everybody after the webinar's over. And obviously we can send them to the details provided when you signed up. And I think that's everything that I need to deal with. So I'm going to hand over to Owen Greenhall, who is one of the co-chairs of the protest team in Garden Court. He's also one of the co-chairs of the Netpol lawyers group. And as well as that, he is one of the authors of the protest handbook, both the first and second editions, as well as having a wealth of experience in representing protesters, most recently or most high profile, perhaps, in the Ziegler case that I mentioned before the Supreme Court last year. So Owen, if I can hand over to you to kick off, please.
Thanks very much, Tom, and thanks to everyone for joining. I'm going to take a fairly whistle-stop tour through the provisions of the Act, which relate to sections 12 and 14 of the Public Order Act, the power to impose conditions on marches and assemblies. And I'm going to start by sharing my screen because I've done some slides. So I hope that everybody will be able to see the slides on the screen now. Okay, so I'll start with a very brief history of the Public Order Act. It started in 1936 as a response to fascist marches. The government gave the police powers to impose conditions on and to ban processions, so processions and marches, but there was no restriction that could be put on assemblies. And that remained in force for about 50 years. And then there was a white paper prior to the government passing the Public Order Act 1986. And that looked at various forms of demonstration and other forms of public order issues that had arisen. And it's very important to note that it wasn't simply protests that it was looked at, it was disorder more generally. And that referred to National Front rallies, the picket at Grunwicks, the miners' strikes, the Brixton riots, disorder at football matches, and importantly that for recent masses has stopped the city demonstrations in the early 80s where there was disruption on the roads causing disruption to businesses. And it was in response to that that the government decided to extend the powers that the police had to impose conditions on static assemblies. But importantly, the police could only impose a very limited range of conditions and there was no power to ban assemblies. And the government stated in the white paper that the government has been very concerned not to extend statutory controls over static demonstrations any further than strictly necessary. Now, looking at the commencement of the Police Crime Sentencing and Courts Act 2022, Priti Patel, when introducing this act, said the following. The right to peacefully protest is a cornerstone of our democracy. This government will always defend. But there is, I know what they say about what comes before the but, there is, of course, a balance to be struck between the rights of the protester and the rights of individuals to go about their daily lives. The current legislation the police use to manage protests, Public Order 86, was enacted over 30 years ago. And in recent years, she claimed, there has been a significant change of protest tactics, with protesters exploiting gaps in the law which have led to disproportionate amounts of disruption. Last year, we saw XR blocking the passage of an ambulance and emergency calls, gluing themselves to a train during rush hour, blocking airport runways, preventing hundreds of hardworking people from going to work. And finally, I would like to gently remind the House that on one day last year, many people across the country were prevented from reading their morning newspapers due to the tactics of some groups. And those were supposedly the new and different forms of protest which justified bringing in extensive and sweeping reforms to the Public Order Act. If you look back at the types of disruption which was motivated the initial Public Order Act, you can see that there's absolutely no difference in the sorts of problems that were arising. These types of protests have been around forever. The level of disruption has been the same as it has ever been. And there's absolutely nothing new to justify any new sort of police powers. But nonetheless, it's very significantly targeting demonstrations by Extinction Rebellion. The Home Secretary felt because it was necessary to bring in changes. And in brief, the changes are changes to the definition of serious disruption for the purposes of the Public Order Act, new powers to control noisy protests, ministerial amendments of the definitions concerned in the police powers, freeing up the conditions which can be imposed on assemblies, the ability to put conditions on one person protests, and change to the requirement of knowledge of conditions before a criminal offence is committed. So, looking at the old law, Section 14 of the Public Order Act provided a power to a senior police officer who believes that a public assembly may result in serious public disorder, serious damage to property, or serious disruption to the life of the community, and all that there is the purpose is to intimidate others. The officer can give directions imposing on the persons organizing or taking part in the assembly such conditions as to, and it's now limited, the place where the assembly may be, its maximum duration, or the maximum numbers of persons who may constitute it. And those conditions have to be necessary to prevent disorder, damage, disruption, or intimidation. That was the old power. That was similar to the power that the police had to control processions, although that power in relation to processions didn't have the specific limitations on the type of conditions imposed. Now, the new power includes a specific statutory definition of what may constitute serious disruption. Serious disruption is an action which may result in significant delay to the delivery of a time-sensitive product to consumers of that product. And that a time-sensitive product means a product whose value or use to its consumers may be significantly reduced by a delay in the supply of the product to them. And I don't think that the government had fresh milk deliveries in mind when it passed this provision. It is very, very clearly thinking about the supply of newspapers. So it's an almost direct response to some of the Extinction Rebellion protests in relation to newspapers. It also added another definition of serious disruption, something which results in prolonged disruption of access to any essential goods or essential services. And that includes the supply of money, food, water, or importantly, energy or fuel. It also refers to system of communication, place of worship, transport facilities, educational institutions, or health services. Again, it's quite clear that these conditions have particular demonstrations in mind. In particular, one might think the demonstrations by Just Stop Oil and anti-fracking demonstrations in relation to fuel supply, and Extinction Rebellion demonstrations in relation to transport facilities. So there is a statutory extension of what may constitute serious disruption, which allows for a greater leeway to the police to impose conditions on processions or assemblies. There is also a reference to noise and that noisy protests can be specifically targeted by the police. So where the noise generated by persons taking part in an assembly can result in serious disruption to the activities of an organisation carried on in the vicinity of the assembly, that is another trigger for the imposition of condition on the protest. And that includes where it may result in persons connected with the organisation not being reasonably able for a prolonged period of time to carry on in the vicinity of the demonstration activities that they have been normally undertaking. And also as an alternative, the noise can have a statutory definition of when it has a relevant impact on persons in the vicinity, and when that impact is significant. So noise may have a relevant impact on persons in the vicinity of an assembly if it results in intimidation or harassment of a person of reasonable firmness with the characteristics of persons likely to be in the vicinity, or it may cause such persons to suffer alarm or distress. And then in order to assess the significance of the impact, police officer has to consider the likely number of persons affected, the duration and the intensity of the impact. Now, clearly, this has an application in relation to assemblies and processions that take place outside that particularly sensitive organizations. So demonstrations outside schools, outside hospitals, where persons who are considered to be vulnerable are likely to be in the vicinity, there's going to be a greater power to impose conditions on that basis. But it is very much a widening of the basis on which conditions may be imposed, and it brings in the need to look very clearly at the context within which any particular demonstration takes place. And if those changes to the statutory definitions, the statutory trigger conditions for imposing conditions were not enough, there is now a new power given to ministers to amend the definition of serious life to the community or serious disruption to activities and organizations. So they can add further examples to yet what further widen the basis on which conditions can be imposed on either an assembly or a procession. There are new changes to the conditions which can be imposed on an assembly. And this is a change specifically relating to assemblies, not processions. So the old definition, as I said earlier, had limitations in terms of the types of conditions which could be imposed. It was a condition on place, duration, number of persons, etc. That has now been removed. The new condition is simply allows a police officer to impose such conditions as appear to the officer to be necessary in order to prevent the disruption that he considers arising. This is a very significant extension in format of conditions that can be imposed. It gives yet further discretion to a police officer, and it is going to bring the type of condition very much into focus. So when the threshold for imposing any sort of condition has been reduced to almost nothing, the focus then turns to what particular condition a police officer imposes. And if a police officer imposes a condition which has some obviously discriminatory effect, then that is going to be a basis on which a challenge might be brought. For example, a police officer who decided to impose a condition that only people with red hair can attend a certain protest, that is going to be a condition that is going to be obviously challengeable. But the discriminatory impact of conditions may not always be as immediately apparent as something like that, and that is certainly an area where legal challenges are likely to arise. It also very much emphasizes that the context sensitive nature of these powers and the assessment of the proportionality and the legality of the imposition of these conditions is going to depend very much on context sensitive factors. If police are imposing some predetermined set of conditions from a sort of tick box approach, that is something which is going to be more liable to challenge than something conditions that are specifically tailored to the particular scene in front of them. That is the changes to the existing section 12 and 14 powers. There are now new powers to impose conditions on what are called one person protests. And this is important because this is the first time that the word protest is actually used in the Public Order Act. The Public Order Act previously was an act which dealt with public order, public disorder. It included the offences of riot and violent disorder, which can arise outside a pub on on a particularly rowdy Saturday night. They were not specifically targeted at demonstrations. Obviously, demonstrations fell within the powers, but they weren't the only target of the powers. Whereas the new Section 14 ZA, power to impose conditions on one person protest, is a power specifically designed to affect protests and only protests. A noisy person who is not protesting does not fall within the category of people on whom such conditions can be imposed. It is only if such a person is protesting that they fall liable to this. And basically, the power is imposing, it takes the noise provisions that are in the, have been introduced in relation to processions and assemblies, and applies them to one person protests. That is how it works. And the types of conditions, again, are not restricted. They can impose conditions on a route of a moving protest. They can impose a condition on a single person entering any public place whilst protesting. And it's an offence which carries 6 months imprisonment. The other change that's been brought in under the to the new public order powers is the change to the mental element required for committing an offence under these powers. So after the condition, the police have imposed conditions on either an assembly or a procession, if a person fails to comply with that condition, then they would commit an offence. And the old offence required a person to knowingly fail to comply. So they had to know what the condition was. And it was also a defence to prove that any such failure arose from circumstances beyond their control. And maximum sentence was a fine for organisers. It was of a demonstration, 3 months in prison. The new offence changes the mental element required. So the offence is if you fail to comply and you knew or ought to have known about the condition that had been imposed. There's no elaboration given on in what circumstances a person ought to know about a condition imposed on a protest. It doesn't, there's no, you know, many protests don't have specific organisers, so there's may well not be any particular individual who it is possible to ask about conditions on protest. There's no nothing that says under statute that you have to ask any police officer who happens to be in the vicinity, have you put condition on this protest? What it appears to be targeting are instances in which people cover their ears or try and turn away from police officers when they are reading out conditions on protests. But there has always been provision in the criminal law where people deliberately turn their minds away from people, police officers imposing conditions to fix them with knowledge on the doctrine of willful blindness. A demonstrator, a person subject to condition, retains a defence to prove that the failure to comply with conditions arose from circumstances beyond their control. And it may well be that that is an area which is going to get a lot more focus in terms of criminal matters coming through the courts. The maximum sentence has also been increased. The level of fine has gone up. And for organisers, those participating in a one-person protest, maximum sentence increased to 6 months in prison. So that is basically the in quick form, the changes to the police powers on under the Public Order Act, all of them giving greater powers to the police, all of them making it easier for them to restrict the right to protest. The final point to mention is that the new Act has changed the offence of public nuisance. That used to be a common law offence. It's now being put on a statutory footing. And the offence is created if there is a person that does an act or an omission that creates a risk or causes serious harm to the public or obstructs the public in the exercise or enjoyment of a right which is available to all. The mental element of the offence is either intent or recklessness. What is interesting in the Act is the definition of what constitutes serious harm. It includes death or personal injury, fair enough, includes loss of or damage to property, and the extent of damage to property isn't defined. and that is clearly of concern. And it also includes serious distress, serious annoyance, serious inconvenience, or serious loss of amenity. Quite what is supposed to constitute serious annoyance or serious inconvenience is left undefined. Protests, as Lord Justice Laws stated in Tabernacle, are often considered to be annoying, particularly by people who are opposed to them. But in many ways, that's the point. And what constitutes annoyance versus serious annoyance is going to depend very much on a person's point of view. Just to finish with a couple of positive notes, the maximum sentence for the statutory offence of public nuisance is 10 years. In fact, the common law offence had a maximum sentence of life imprisonment. So I suppose that is a slight reduction there. More significantly, the statutory offence of public nuisance has a defence of reasonable excuse. And then the question is whether that statutory defence will give rise to consideration of matters relating to freedom of expression and Article 10 and 11 of the European Convention. That point in relation to the common law offence of public nuisance in the case of Brown was conceded obliquely as it arose in that case, but there's not been a definitive ruling on the point. And how that pans out in relation to the statutory offence is going to remain to be seen. So on that slightly positive note, I'm going to end and hand over to the next speaker.
Actually, just before we hand over to the next speaker, although I did say question and answer at the end, but just one question arising out of the points that you've raised, Owen. And interestingly, I picked up on the fact that this is the first time that protest is used in this legislation, possibly in any legislation. But the definition of protest will be an interesting issue for the court, won't it? Because you said someone who's making a lot of noise in public won't necessarily be or won't be a protester. But you know, if you've got someone not necessarily campaigning about a political issue or something along those lines, but someone complaining about the fact that you haven't been allowed into a nightclub could be said to be protesting about that. So it seems it's an extraordinarily wide term, widens that, and particularly as it only, you know, it can apply to just one person protests. I don't know if you're aware, are there any other definitions either in the European or other legislation or in the case law which the court will take into account, or is it going to be a dictionary definition thing?
I'm not aware of the Act defines, says a one person protest is effectively a protest by one person. It's not particularly illuminating. The European Convention in relation to protest defines the rights of freedom of expression and freedom of assembly rather than specifically protests, and freedom of expression is effectively any peaceful expressive act. So I imagine one would have to look at the convention in order to get guidance on the interpretation of what constitutes a protest. But I think what is most significant is it is a specifically having a power for protest rather than public disorder more widely shows very much the sort of flavor of the government's approach, and that they are seeing protest as the problem, not public disorder as the problem, which may arise in the protest context and other contexts. And that's clear just from all the rhetoric about the motivation behind the Act and why they brought it in and what they're doing with it. And my understanding is that the provision, the one person protest provision, is it's now in force, and they are particular individuals that the police are keen to target with it.
Thank you. Lovely. Our next speaker, we're absolutely delighted to have join us Lydia Dagostino of Kellys Solicitors. Lydia is a legendary protests solicitor, been defending activists in criminal proceedings for over 25 years, and is continuing to do so at the moment, in addition to criminal cases in the undercover policing inquiry, acting on behalf of the non-state, non-police participants. So, as I say, we're open to have Lydia join us, and I will hand over to her now.
Thank you, Tom and Owen. I seem to be in quite a privileged position compared to Owen in talking about obstruction of the highway. Section 12 and 14 look to me to be insanely complicated, and I think that it'll be very interesting to see how that all pans out in the courts and the ways to challenge them. Now, I mean, I would say that we have been here before, perhaps not in the same way or to the same extent. I do have a real sense of deja vu in the aftermath of when the Criminal Justice and Public Order Act was brought in 1994, criminalising aggravated trespass. And what we learn from that is that some provisions tend to be used more than others. And we do find that some provisions fall by the wayside to a certain extent. So, for example, Section 68, aggravated trespass, is used far more than Section 69, failing to leave land. I mean, I'm not saying that it's never used, but we can see that there is a feature that some statutes evolve to be used more than others. In the same way that certain pieces of legislation fall by the wayside, we also see the evolution of sections or pieces of legislation being brought in specifically to target, say, one group, the miners, with the Trade Union Labour Relations Consolidation Act, then being used against activists, and that was used many early days against activists to get, for example, Newbury Bypass, putting up tripods on roads and things like that. So we do see the evolution of legislation. And one thing I would like to start off on a positive note, and that is, in my experience, protest is creative and evolves. And that is something that's really important for activists to look at. And there's lots of ways of getting involved in campaigning, and it can be very scary to go through the criminal justice system, get arrested with the prospect of getting a criminal record. But I think it's really important that if you feel that you can't do that, there's other ways of getting involved in campaigning, whether that's through legal observing, raising awareness in other ways, and looking at the law, analysing it, and basically see what works. This is legislation, unfortunately, with Section 12 and 14, that there does seem to be scope for the government to make it up as they go along and change it to adapt. But I think that's just something to hang on to. It's important for activists to be creative, would be the starting point. I'd like to really start on something positive. So looking at Section 80, which is the main amendment to 137, which is the obstruction of the highway, which has been enforced since 1980. This is one of the tricky things we've had with this legislation, is actually seeing what comes into force and when. Highway obstruction, the changes to highway obstruction actually came into force on the 12th of May, and the new offence will apply to offences on or after the 12th of May 2022. And that's quite significant for people who are released on bail. So if you were arrested for an offence of highway obstruction on the 10th of May 2022, but haven't yet been charged, you would fall under the old law if you're charged after the 12th of May. So the statute says that the commencement is on or after the 12th of May. And that might be significant for some activists, because lots of activists are now released on bail for extended periods of time, sometimes even up to and over a year, while the police carry out inquiries or the matter goes to the CPS for advice. So just a reminder that highway obstruction is an offence that can only be tried in the magistrates' court. There is no power to elect to go before the jury. And the significant changes are, and this is again in the knee-jerk reaction in response to some of the Extinction Rebellion and Insulate Britain protests, if it is no longer a defence to say that the highway is already blocked by a police cordon, or to do with traffic management, or to do with the council. Now, the exact wording of the offence is quite simple, so I'll read it out. There's a new section 1B, which says, for the purposes of this section, it does not matter whether free passage along the highway in question has already been temporarily restricted or temporarily prohibited, whether by a constable, traffic authority, or otherwise. So we may find the key word is otherwise. We've actually got a case being prosecuted at the moment, a highway obstruction, very rarely being prosecuted by the complex case unit who are responsible for doing very serious Crown Court cases. It's under the old legislation, but in that case, the road was blocked because of a separate protest that was taking part on a roof. So it would clearly there'd be some leeway and some challenge as to what falls in with the or otherwise definition. The Crown will seek to interpret it as widely as possible. And we would want to say that it's restricted and as narrow as possible. But it'd be, at the end of the day, it'd be for the courts to decide. So with other pieces of the legislation, the National Police Chiefs Council does issue guidance. They haven't issued guidance yet in relation to these changes, and particularly highway obstruction. But a good place to look for changes to legislation is often the Crown Prosecution Service website, because they sometimes update their website relatively quickly so prosecutors can adapt and assess what the advice on the law is. And currently they have, as of today, uploaded a section which does cover the 12th of May changes to highway obstruction. And they give the example that this change in section to in relation to the amendment I just read out, it says it covers, for instance, situations where the police temporarily close a highway in order to manage a protest or for the protection of highway users or other protesters. In such circumstances, it is still possible to commit the offence during the temporary restriction or prohibition. And the background to this is those early Extinction Rebellion protests starting, the big ones starting in April 2019, where some of you will remember the pink boat, and then the actions on the bridges, where some of the bridges were blocked for several days and some people turned up and literally protested momentarily, some even minutes, and they were arrested for highway obstruction. If they were to say, well, I turned up, the road was blocked, there was cordons at both ends, there was nothing I could do, it is now no longer a defence to be able to say that I literally sat there for minutes. And I'll come to what the impact of that might be. The other significant change, I think, is that it will now be, because it's become imprisonable, it will now be a recordable offence. So previously, highway obstruction was a non-recordable offence, and the police shouldn't have taken fingerprints and DNA. In fact, they did, and I had an argument with one police officer in the aftermath of the April 2019 rebellion, where people were being interviewed for highway obstruction, and the officer said, well, they need to give their fingerprints and DNA. And I said, no, they don't. And he said, well, everyone else has. And it's like two wrongs don't actually make a right. Just because other people had given their fingerprints and DNA to the police, it doesn't mean that the people who I was with, one of the London police stations, had to do it. And in the end, they did back down because it wasn't a recordable offence. But it is quite significant, I think, that it's a sort of hidden limb and a hidden impact with increasing the sentence of obstruction of the highway, is that it will give the police the entitlement to take fingerprints and DNA. That information gets stored on the police national computer, and it does give the police the opportunity to create an intelligence picture of activists, and they may be able to use that information subsequently. If there was a big action, then they'd have fingerprints stored on the database and may be able to link back. So just to sort of bear in mind that I think that's a hidden addition that isn't necessarily clear on the face of the legislation. The other significant change is the sentencing structure. And for the first time, previously highway obstruction, the maximum sentence was a fine. The change now is that there will be an unlimited fine, and highway obstruction will become imprisonable with a maximum sentence of 6 months imprisonment. Now, that sounds really scary, suddenly for something to be from a fine to having something that's imprisonable. can put a lot of activists off. Although there has been an increase in more recently in activists getting custodial sentences, they are still very, very few and far between. Given the number of activists who are arrested, it is still unusual. I think there's an increased trend to custodial prison sentences, but it is still unusual. And what we see with other offences is that there's a sort of structure, and if it's a first offence, you are still likely to be sentenced to the least possible sentence, which is either an absolute discharge or a conditional discharge. It is if you go back repeatedly, perhaps even in the same protest or a week later or 2 weeks later, that the sentencing, if you are found guilty, can start increasing and going up the scale from fine through to a community order, which can involve working for the community, even a suspended prison sentence or ultimately custody. But custody, go back to the point, is very rare. Now, another hidden consequence that people often forget about is you do have to declare this for insurance. Now, that may not sound hugely significant, but if you get a conviction, sometimes you have to declare that for when you're claiming for insurance, and it depends on what you are convicted for. So there's all these additional hidden punishments, if you like. There are no sentencing guidelines. It will emerge as to how people get treated. There has been one significant case that people will no doubt be aware of the James Brown, who was sentenced to a custodial sentence by the court and the Court of Appeal. Although they reduced the sentence, they did still say that a custodial sentence was appropriate. So there is that precedent, but I think it's quite significant in that he superglued himself to a plane, and I think there's a lot of fear around direct action at airports, and so they do tend to come, the state does tend to come down more heavily on people, activists involved in actions at or particularly on airport bases. So as far as defences go, Ziegler is still law, and so it would still apply that you could argue that your conduct was proportionate. You can still argue that Article 10 and 11 apply. Obviously, this government maybe will be reviewing the Human Rights Act, so that those changes do remain to be seen. And obviously, it does feel that the screw is really turning on activists. But I think that it's about continuing to, if you don't feel that you can participate in action, then do other things, but obviously read up and get to know the law and keep an eye on how the cases progress. Because obviously as defences emerge, one thing we do is with various Netpol meetings and the lawyers groups, we share what works and what doesn't work. And it will become widely available what does work as a particular defence in a case. So keep an eye on the guidance. The law is changing significantly and rapidly. And it is actually quite hard to keep up with. I was struggling to find out when particular things came into force, and some aspects have come in today. I've just noticed there's a post in the chat as well that there's reference to declaring for work and visas and coming up an enhanced DBS checks. Thanks, Jude. That's another factor. But I think with enhanced DBS checks and visas, sometimes it is okay if it is a highway obstruction. There can be more problems if there are what the state sees as offences of violence, particularly if you're working with children or other vulnerable groups. So the defence in law of reasonable excuse still applies. It remains to be seen how many other changes are brought in, but it is still, you can obstruct the highway as part of a protest. You may get arrested. I don't think people should be put off by the fact that the sentence has increased. It is very rare to actually get sent to prison. So if anyone else has got any other questions about high obstruction, we can deal with it at the end. Bottom line, the title of the webinar is how will these changes impact on the right to protest? They will, but as going back to my first point, it is up to activists to be creative and keep an eye and think about how best to protest and what they can do to get their voices heard so that they're not silenced by this government. Okay, over and out.
Thanks, Lydia. I'm going to now introduce Audrey Cherryl Mogan, another member of the Garden Court protest team, one of our steering committee, and she is one of the rising stars in protest criminal defence work, having represented, amongst many others, Extinction Rebellion, protesters at Stonehenge, Heathrow Paws, many, many others. She is also a director of Black Protest Legal Support, and last year was the winner of the Legal Aid Newcomer of the Year at the Legal Aid Lawyer of the Year Awards, or the Lallies, as we call them. So we're looking forward to hearing Audrey talking about the forthcoming public order bill. Over to you.
Thanks, Tom. Yep, so what's next? That's what I'm going to speak about. When the police crime sentencing and courts bill was going through Parliament, effectively, the government introduced significant new amendments, late stage amendments, that they wanted to go into the Act. And the House of Lords basically all but one rejected all but one of those amendments. And effectively what we're seeing now is they make a return in the public order bill, which is a quite concerning indication of the dedication this government has to make sure that they can introduce these hugely troubling provisions that will definitely have a chilling effect on the right to protest. This is nothing else but clamping down and criminalizing direct action. I don't want to call them tactics. It's direct action protests that have been used. Owen's already gone through it. It's nothing new. It's been used by the suffragettes. It's been used by people fighting against apartheid in South Africa. These are historical, hard and fast, ways in which people have protested against some of the most horrific things in our history. And now this government effectively, clearly because of how good and how effective things like the XR campaigns have been, want to pull in provisions to, and I would say nothing more than scare protesters, potential protesters, and penalize them for just exercising their rights. I mean, we'd already seen before this bill, before the Act has come into force, and before this new bill had been proposed, is that, we'd seen facial recognition technology being used against protesters. We've already talked about James Brown, but, even if people weren't getting immediate custodial sentences, there were lots of cases in which, young people, people of good character, taking direct action protests were even getting things like suspended sentences, which is quite serious. During the pandemic, of course, the police thought that they could blanketedly ban protests because of the COVID regulations, which they were wrong about. And we also know that legal observers there in full kit observing what was going on were arrested during some of the Kill the Bill protests. So it has definitely been a move towards more and more draconian powers. And that is culminating in the new public order bill. The Joint Committee on Human Rights has warned the government effectively that the new policing powers in the bill risk creating a hostile environment for peaceful protesters and put our fundamental democratic rights at risk. But again, as I've already said it before, despite them being struck down in the House of Lords when the PCSE bill was coming in, this government has now proposed that these same things come back in a public order bill. So what are those proposals? Well, first, they're proposing a new locking on offences. So I'll just read it out to you. And let me just say, Netpol has an excellent explainer on their website about all of this. So, I don't have slides, but go to their website and you'll see a really good explainer about the new public order bill. But effectively what new locking on offenses means is that anyone that locks themselves onto another person, an object or land and subsequently causes or could cause serious disruption to two or more individuals or an organization. So i.e. you lock yourself onto another person and you're protesting, then an offense is committed. And right now it's the maximum penalty of 6 months, but there and or an unlimited fine, but that could increase to 51 weeks when another act comes in, potentially comes into force. Now, what is really worrying about this is, one, again, this is something that suffragettes used to give women the right to vote, but attaching yourself, attached is not defined. You could literally be linking arms with another person and be guilty of this offense. So, you know, we could talk about things like super glue and lock-ons in those tubes, but even linking arms with another person could potentially make you guilty of this, face up to 6 months in prison. In addition to this offense, they also propose a new offense of going equipped for locking on. Criminal lawyers on the panel will know that there's, you know, offenses of going equipped for burglary, theft, things like that, which I've always thought are problematic because you haven't done anything. You haven't even attempted to do anything, but you might have stuff that suggests that you might do something. And, you know, we're talking about burglaries and thefts, and instead now it's being brought into the protest sphere with a new offense of going equipped for locking on. And then effectively the definition is in anywhere other than a dwelling, with the intention that it may be used in the course or of or in connection with an attempt to lock on. Yeah, you could be guilty of this offense. Like I said, I mean, things like having a bicycle de-lock, which I'm sure a lot of environmental protesters probably just have on them all the time. Or of course, things like super glue. But I mean, funny enough, I mean, if a lock-on could just be linking arms, I mean, wouldn't that just mean even just having arms is effectively going equipped to lock on? But anyway, that's this government. And again, maximum penalty for this is an unlimited fine. And it's if there's a suspicion that someone is going to commit the offense also of obstructing a highway, public nuisance, and the other offenses proposed in the bill. Again, I'm going to go through this kind of quickly, but there is a really good explainer on Netpol's website. The other thing that they're proposing is extending stop and search powers. Now, this government knows, I mean, I don't know how many times reports have to come out to say that any extension of stop and search powers are going to disproportionately affect Black, Brown, and racialized communities. Already, things like the Section 60 powers, you know, Black and Brown individuals are more than 40 times, especially Black individuals are more than 40 times likely to be stopped under those Section 60 powers. So extending these with kind of what is effectively somewhat new blanket powers is only going to have a further detrimental effect on communities, Black, Brown, and racialized communities. What it says is things like effectively suspicion is needed, but you don't need reasonable suspicion, don't need reasonable grounds. And you can, in fact, for a 24-hour period, put on bans in areas and full stop and search even without suspicion. So it is really, really problematic. And again, will target certain groups and communities and further disproportionate impact on certain communities. Another offense is interference with key infrastructure. Now, this is really interesting because it proposes an offense of interfering with the use or operation of any key national infrastructure in England and Wales, or in intending to interfere with them. But what this means is sites of power, places where people would want to protest. And it, not for the first time, and, you know, the importance of the location of protests has been spoken about time and time again. I'll just quote very quickly Lord Neuberger in Hall and others, but effectively the right to express views publicly, particularly on the important issues about which the defendants feel so strongly and the rights of defendants to assemble for the purposes of expressing and discussing those views extends to the manner in which the defendants wish to express their views and to the location where they wish to express their views. You know, I've said it before, being allowed to protest in a place that is completely out of the way, where no one can see and hear you, and chosen by the government, is not a right to protest at all. So this idea of, you know, an offense of interfering with key infrastructure, and as Owen already mentioned, I believe, even in this offense, the government can, and Parliament can, amend or change the definition of what infrastructure is. So the goalpost will continually be moving, that's for sure, as you're more and more effective in the protests. But it does already say things like road transport, rail, air transport, harbors, downstream refining of crude oil, downstream processing and purification of natural gas, onshore oil and gas exploration and production, onshore electricity generation, or newspaper printing infrastructure. I mean, they might as well have just called this the anti-XR bill. I mean, that would have been probably more appropriate. And again, this offense has a maximum penalty of 6 months imprisonment and or an unlimited fine, or at 12 months in the Crown Court. It's an either way offense. Then they go on to obstruction of major transport works, and that is obstructing construction staff from taking any steps that are reasonably necessary for the purposes of facilitating or in connection with the construction or maintenance of any major transport works. And I don't think I need to explain to anybody on this webinar what that's directed at. And the maximum penalty is 6 months imprisonment and or a fine. Now, I want to move quickly on to serious disruption prevention orders. And this is really, really interesting in the most problematic way. Because one, these are civil orders. So like, and I've spoken about this and lots of people at Garden Court have spoken about things like criminal behavior orders, that because they're civil orders and have the civil standard of proof, they're used quite widely and are hugely problematic. But what is really interesting about this, and it ties into what Owen was saying about the PCSE bill, is this is all about protests. There's no question about it. These serious disruption prevention orders, the conditions that need to be met are that someone has committed a protest-related offense, committed a breach of an injunction leading to a conviction of contempt of court. Now, again, we know that there are quite widely defined injunctions, person unknown injunctions. So all of that comes into place. Again, or a person has carried out activities related to protest, a person has caused or contributed to the commission by any other person of a protest-related offense. Now this I find quite interesting because if you're at a protest and you're just standing there as a protester with a placard and, you know, cheering or, you know, chanting or whatever, that could be argued that you are encouraging or assisting the commission of potentially an offense by another person. So what is really concerning to me is that this idea of this kind of joint enterprise protest related offense is going to basically pick up anybody and everybody who's attending a protest. So it is quite problematic that this is, even though they're called serious disruption prevention orders, everything in it is about protests. It's all about people engaged in protests. And the fact is, you don't need to be convicted of an offense to actually, it doesn't have to be within the ambit of a criminal proceeding. So you don't have to be charged with something and come to court. It's almost like a restraining order. I mean, actually, that is what it is. They're restraining you from your right to protest. But as long as the conditions are met, even if you're not within the criminal justice system at the time, a serious disruption prevention order can be made. And like CBOs, the types of things that they can require you not to do and prevent you from doing are things like not associating with named people, not going to certain areas, and in fact, banning people from attending protests altogether. You know, this is going to be a very, this is going to be used clearly at targeting some of the central organizers of some of the biggest protests that have happened so far. And, you know, I'm concerned about what kind of data gathering will go on in relation to them. But it is effectively saying to people, even if you're not within criminal proceedings, that you won't be able to assemble with others. There's even things like electronic monitoring. People can be subject to that for up to a year. And effectively, what I would say is that all of the stuff in the public order bill, already struck down, trying again, of course they are, just does really risk not just criminalizing people that, you know, are exercising their rights to protest, but that chilling effect is more than that. It's stopping people from actually even engaging in protests in the first place because of this real threat to protesters, a real fear I would imagine that people might have. And final thing just to say about this is that there is a defense, but it's a reverse burden. So it is for the defendant to show that they had a reasonable excuse for almost all of these offenses that I've mentioned, for the defendant to show.
Audrey, I think the sound's gone. Someone else has said in the chat, I don't think we can hear you. I think your microphone.
Oh,
there you go. You're back.
Am I back? Oh, sorry about that. I think, yeah. sorry. I was just saying it's a reverse burden of proof. So a defendant would have to show they have a reasonable excuse to the civil standard, which is the balance of probabilities. It's used in other offenses, but offenses like carrying a knife in a public place. And what we're talking about is people exercising their right to protest. And that is, I mean, that's probably the best way of saying that's how this government is viewing the right to protest. Now, the biggest thing, and just to conclude, that really kind of showed the public outcry in relation to the PCSE bill was people taking to the streets. I know I've said all these really scary things about what might happen to you, but that's what happened. The Kill the Bill protests really did show that people weren't going to stand for this. And, you know, I think it's really important that we take to the streets about this as well. Otherwise, if we ignore it, you know, the right to protest just won't exist anymore. But just to conclude on a positive note, when they come for you like this, you know you're doing something right.
Thanks, Audrey. So we will have time for questions. I think we can go on to 7 o'clock. But before we do, we are lucky to hear from Emily Apple, who's the communications coordinator for Netpol, who's here to talk to us a little bit about the Defend Dissent campaign that Netpol are running.
Yeah, thank you. I'm going to be brief, so I'll have time for questions as well. And just thank you to all the speakers and to Garden Court for hosting this, because I think it's so needed at the moment and for people to get a feel of what is going on and the attacks that are happening against us all. So in terms of Netpol, we've launched our Defend Dissent campaign, particularly in response to the Police Crime Sentencing and Courts Act, but obviously it will take into account the Public Order Bill and anything else that sort of comes through. My bit of positivity to begin with is that protest is still legal. We do still have the right to protest, and so much of this stuff is about fear, and there is a lot to be afraid of, but we do still have that right. And it's really important that we remember that and we exercise it. And, you know, just because the police have these powers, like, we haven't lost the fight against the Policing Act. What we've got is a new fight. We've got a fight about how it's enforced, about us making it enforceable, about what legal challenges we can bring to it. So this isn't the end at all. And with all these things, it's an evolution, and we have to work out how we respond. And I think Lydia put it beautifully about being creative as well. We need to think around this and what are the best things to do. So in terms of Netpol and Defending Dissent, one of the things that we want to do over the next 2 years is to monitor how these powers are being used, so, and how they're being abused. So how will it be used by different police forces? identifying where it's not, where it's being used, where it's incompatible with human rights legislation, where it's being used discriminatorily, where it's targeting certain groups, like, you know, and other speakers have brought this out, but it's really clear that all these different bits of legislation, like, they've got particular groups in mind, like, it's kind of so targeted, and that will spread across lots and lots of other groups, but it's likely that certain groups will be more affected than other groups, so we want to be able to sort of monitor that. So we want to get people's personal stories, we want data on restrictions, data on arrests, and what that impact is as well. So, like, if you've been put off going to a protest because of this new legislation, where is that chilling effect coming in, and how is that sort of manifesting itself? And so we want to do a report on all of these things, of bringing all these things together. So if you have any experiences of how this legislation is being used, please get in touch with us and let us know what's going on, so that we can start collating that. And also it will help us work with the lawyers as well, to work out where there might be cases for sort of legal challenges, and sort of really bring sort of some of this work together. Then in terms of our campaign, generally there's sort of other elements to it. It's been touched on with the surveillance, with the serious disruption prevention orders. And I think also with the public nuisance and some of this other stuff, one of our fears and probably likelihoods of all this new legislation will be increased surveillance. So we're also sort of campaigning around resisting surveillance, what people can do to keep themselves safe, what information are you putting in the public domain, how do you manage that? And also surveillance on protests, whether we're going to go back to more overt surveillance, because for a lot of these things, like those orders, they're going to be collecting that intelligence and that surveillance in order to build these cases. So it's really important how we look at this, how we resist it, and how we keep each other safe. Knowing your rights, Green and Black Cross are running lots of Know Your Rights training, so sort of check out sort of when they're coming up. There's lots of information out there as well, but the more we know and the more we can inform ourselves and inform each other, we'll be in a much better position to sort of resist some of this stuff. And finally, and I think really importantly, is that collective solidarity across movements. The government relies on, and states rely on, divide and rule, as saying there's good protesters and there's bad protesters. There's protesters who create disruption, there's protesters that fight back, or whatever it is. We need to not let that happen. We need to keep that solidarity absolute amongst all the different groups and against people who use different tactics and stuff like that. And really, that solidarity is that power. And that's what we saw a lot with the groups coming together with the Kill the Bill movement. And a lot of those groups are doing sort of some of the cop watching stuff and the monitoring the police now, which is brilliant. But how we keep that going and we support each other, because these are scary times, but there are ways that we can work through this together, and there's ways that we can support each other through it. And quite often, my last positive note to end on is, sometimes when there's a lot of repression, it's when people start fighting back, it's when people start coming together, and it's when people start making a difference. This legislation is because people are scared of our power to do stuff and to affect change. They don't want that change. We do. We've got to use that power. So I'll end on a positive note for that.
Thanks, Emily. Right, I'm going to try and get through as many questions as possible in the remaining 20 minutes. Just picking up on one first of all, and I think I'll ask Owen about this. There's a question in the Q&A, bearing in mind what you've said about one-person protests and noisy protests, what happens with a one-person silent protest? And they refer to Greta Thunberg being that outside the Norwegian Parliament. And just before you come to it, I remember, you've always got to look out for the bylaws. We did cases in Parliament Square with Occupy Parliament. There's a bylaw saying you can't hold up a notice in Parliament Square. And so one of the activists had a blank piece of paper and was running around holding that. And I think they dropped that one in the end. But Owen, just to help us, what is the position? Is a one person silent protest caught by this legislation or potentially any other legislation?
The answer is one person silent protest are not caught. So the threshold to impose conditions on a one person protest are solely based on noise. So it's noisy one person protests, and the conditions for noise being disruptive to activity in the vicinity are the same as in the other provisions, but it's only the noise provisions that relate to one person protests. So Greta Thunberg won't be captured by that provision. As to whether she's captured by anything else, well, it probably depends a little bit on the context. Just picking up on a couple of the other questions that I've seen in the chat very quickly. Patrick asked, will public nuisance be charged more now it's put on a statutory footing? I think it will. I think historically there's been some reluctance to charge public nuisance because it's a common law offence and it's felt a little bit uncertain. That in general has fallen away in recent years and it's been used more even as a common law offence, but now it's on a statutory footing. I think it certainly is likely to be used more often. Although the only counterbalance to that is the fact that obstruction of the highway now carries a potential prison sentence. It may be felt that obstruction of the highway can capture some of the more lower level public nuisance offences. So that may take away from charging.
I'm just going to pause you there. So I'm going to jump through as many questions as I can. There's a question in the chat about on the provision that someone ought to have known the conditions on a protest and how that factors in individual circumstances such as neurodiversity. And I'm not sure whether that provision is going to be interpreted purely objectively, whether it would be the reasonable person by which that would be interpreted as what the magistrate I think is reasonable, or whether it will take into account those particular factors. So I don't know if anyone wants to come in on that. But the other point to that provision I thought was interesting is that it imposes a positive obligation on protesters to have to go out and check for these conditions. And those positive obligations they're quite rare in criminal law. And it's a worrying sign because it doesn't look like much necessarily, but it's recasting protest as a privilege to be earned rather than a right to which you're entitled. I think that's really the sort of worrying implication of it. Does anyone want to come in on the anything more about how ought to will be interpreted?
I agree with you that it's an open question as to whether or not specific characteristics of the person concerned will be taken into account in deciding whether they ought to have known about a condition. In relation to imposing a positive obligation, I think it's a very interesting question how far that positive obligation can be said to be imposed by this. It's one thing to say someone ought to have known about a condition on a protest if police officers are handing out notices to individuals and the notice is put in someone's hand and they just choose not to look down and read it. It's very different to say that someone has to approach a police officer who happens to be passing and say, excuse me, is there a condition on this assembly here? And I think that proportionality arguments in terms of protecting the rights to freedom of assembly are going to be used to limit the extent to which a positive obligation can be imposed beyond the general normative ought to have known.
Tom, if I could just say something very quickly about that as well. During the BLM marches, there was a lot of tweeting going on by police forces. And so that's also going to be quite problematic, because is that going to be some way that they think, well, we've told you about it because we put it on our Twitter page, we put it on our social media, that kind of usage of social media to tell people and warn people about things, and how that will interplay with individuals ought to have known. But yeah.
Yeah, there we go. Another reason to leave Twitter. There's a question about someone domiciled in Scotland, travelling to England, Wales. I presume, unless someone corrects me, that it would be based on where the action took place. So this would cover the whole of England and Wales. And I think that English and Welsh police can ask, or courts can ask, for people who are living in Scotland and probably Northern Ireland to be arrested and brought to court, unless and until Scotland get independence.
On the Scottish point, I focused entirely on the law in England and Wales, but it is interesting to note that quite a lot of these provisions don't apply to Scotland. For example, the one person process doesn't apply to Scotland. The provision allowing any conditions to be put on assemblies doesn't apply to Scotland. So there's a clear division and greater protection of civil liberties north of the border.
Is it the position any different in Wales? It wouldn't be for criminal justice, would it? There isn't the devolved power. Thank you. We've got questions in the Q&A about the fact that these challenges can only be challenged really ex post facto in the criminal courts. And in terms of civil proceedings, if you know about the conditions in advance, you may be able to get an urgent challenge to the civil courts. But Lydia, where activists are faced with these conditions, obviously with protests, it's the need to protest now. There's an immediacy to it. There is with deportation, someone is being deported now. We can't wait a week or however long, or if I am arrested and it's sorted out by the courts, that's too late. What advice would you give for people who are confronted with these conditions when they go on a protest?
I think the best thing people can do is go informed about what the law is. That's the starting point. And always, I mean, in the XR cases, there were quite a few people acquitted because they didn't know. That's a significant change. They may have been on the phone, or they may not have had the piece of paper given to them. They may not have heard. I mean, I think the best thing to do is to stay quiet, not engage, and certainly not engage with a discussion with the police officer about the conditions, because you don't know how it's going to pan out. And there may be challenges further down the line. I think it's a problem if you turn up and start arguing with an officer about the nature of the conditions, because that suggests that you know them. I still think there is value to be had in the Netpol campaign of see no conditions, speak no conditions, hear no conditions. And we'll have to see how things emerge, how the courts establish that you ought to have known. Now, it may well be that the person sitting next to you is arrested for highway obstruction. So how would you know that the conditions were that you're arrested for Section 14? There's a whole myriad of things that might happen. And I think it's to be on the safe side. I think people should just remain cautious. And I think, you know, people shouldn't be tweeting the conditions. People shouldn't be take on the responsibility of handing out the conditions or passing the information on. I think that if you go to these protests, you still should just stay silent and look after yourself and listen, but don't necessarily talk. That's the key thing, is to listen to what's going on, but you don't necessarily have to say at that time what your thought processes are. That will be decided by the court, whether you ought to have known. And Carolyn's just posted, remain silent once arrested, no chit-chat about any conditions. That's just the firm advice. Keep it all close to your chest. You don't have an obligation to sort of engage about, well, these conditions shouldn't be in place. This law is outrageous. We all know that. There's no point in arguing with the police officer about it, particularly if that is then undermining your defence later on if you're then charged. So I would still say that the advice should be to see, hear, speak no conditions, and let's see how it pans out.
Thank you. A couple of questions again about Articles 10 and 11 of the Convention, which we've mentioned, and whether they're going to be abolished, and whether or not proportionality is important. I thought very briefly that well, they are still important and enforce all of those. The government aren't planning to get rid of Articles 10 and 11, but just reframe it so that it, you know, covers the free speech that they agree with and not the free speech that they don't. The question of whether an imprisonable offence would have to go to the Crown Court, just double checking with Lydia, it wouldn't have to, as I understand it. So far as the increase to 12 months is concerned, I think that has come into force, has it not, for magistrates?
Last time I looked, it hadn't come in. But that's not, I mean, this is the, what I was saying to you earlier. It's really problematic to keep on top of what's coming in when. It's certainly on the face of the Police Crime and Sentencing Courts Act that there's reference to Section 218 when it comes into force. It's Section 218(5) of the Criminal Justice Act 2003, which will increase the powers from 6 months to 51 weeks. But I think everyone's struggling to keep on. It's almost daily that things are changing without very much notice. So if anyone can Google now, when we checked last week, it certainly wasn't in force, but that has been the problem. We know, for example, highway obstruction came in on the 12th of May, but other things are coming in by the day. If anyone has got any confirmation on that, but that's certainly our research, was that it's not currently in force to increase to 6 months. Now, that the important point is that doesn't make it an either way offence. So it doesn't mean you will get to go to the Crown Court. The increase to 51 weeks is increasing the sentencing powers of magistrates to give a greater sentence from the maximum of 6 months. It is rare to get the maximum sentence of 6 months, but that increase doesn't mean that you can elect trial by jury. It may mean that you can appeal to the Crown Court if the sentence is harsh. But we literally had an activist who was sentenced to 14 days, first time offender, no convictions, sprayed Insulate Britain on the side of a court. She was sentenced to 2 weeks custody and the Crown Court upheld that sentence. So this is, it's almost like the state is also rewriting. The state and the courts seem to be going hand in hand in rewriting the rules. It just didn't follow the sentencing guidelines, sentencing a woman of good character to 2 weeks immediate custody when there was no previous convictions. And so even when there are guidelines, the court aren't necessarily always following them. So, so Emily's also heard that it had come in and has checked it out and it hasn't come in. So we're the lawyers and we don't know. That shows you how awful it is at the moment. We're all struggling to keep on top of things. So do keep an eye. And perhaps when that change does come in, it would be really useful to put it on the Netpol website, because I don't think people will start getting immediately 50 weeks in custody when they previously had 6 months. It is just increasing the maximum, so more sentences will be tried in the magistrates' court.
Thanks, Lydia. A good question from Paul in the Q&A. Which aspects of the says the bill, but let's say either the act or the bill, as the bill is currently drafted, which aspect do you think can be challenged with the greatest chance of success? I think to kick off, possibly serious disruption prevention orders, because as Audrey said, and it takes one overzealous magistrate to impose one on someone who themselves wasn't protesting, who's never been convicted of anything, who maybe just gave a lift on two occasions to someone else who has also never been convicted of anything at a protest, but they were there when it may have caused disruption, even though it actually didn't. You know, you can have your right to protest taken away in those circumstances. So I think that's one aspect, which is definitely open to challenge. If we just ask anyone else, Audrey, if you are there. Audrey, which aspects did you think is most open to challenge, or would you most like to challenge?
I mean, I think you kind of stole mine, to be honest, because I do definitely have this real worry about, because I've heard it from judges, you know, in cases where I'm running certain defenses. Yeah, but if they're there, then it could be argued that they were encouraging or assisting it to happen. We already know, I mean, you know, joint enterprise itself for very serious offenses is overused quite a bit, that now bringing that into the protest sector, that is probably the thing I'm quite interested to see how that will come into play with the basically protest banning orders, which is what we should call them. But yeah.
Okay. Emily?
Yeah, I also agree with that, with those orders. I think there's so much scope there for sort of playing with them. I'd be interested to see what happens with the serious inconvenience and serious annoyance part of public nuisance as well, given that's not defined anywhere. And as far as I'm aware, we haven't really got anything to base that on at the moment. So how the state and how we can challenge what the state wants to interpret on that, I think, is potentially interesting as well.
And Owen?
I think that the challenges are going to be much more on the implementation of these powers. So it's going to be on, the focus will be on specific police officers' decisions to impose particular conditions on a particular protest. And it brings everything down to the sort of the street level. And I think high level challenges are going to be difficult. Just on the sentencing powers point, the powers of the magistrates to impose sentences for 12 months for either way offences is in force. For summary only offences is not in force. And the offences we've been talking about are still summary only, so have the 6 month limit at the moment. If that increases, then it will go up to 12 months.
There we go. So everyone was right about that in one way or another. Okay, so I think we're going to have to wrap up in a couple of minutes. Sorry, we haven't managed to get through all of the questions, but there is lots of information out there. Information is being put together. Netpol, Green and Black Cross, in particular. There are challenges which are brewing. There are decisions still being made about the bill in Parliament. It's not too late to lobby to make your voices heard. And I think I just finish by thanking everyone for coming, thanking all of our panelists. It's been really interesting and informative evening, and I hope everyone's enjoyed it. Let's keep up the fight. All right, thank you very much.